2 years ago, the world's nations agreed to try and limit global climate change to less than 2 degrees. To reach this target, we have to limit our cumulative carbon dioxide emissions to less than 1 trillion tons. We already are at 62% of that total. So a big challenge globally is what we do with that remaining 38%. Can we stay within that budget, and who gets to emit that CO2? There's one caveat in these calculations, however, and that is that we assume the biosphere keeps on doing what it's doing. Currently, only 46% of the CO2 that we emit goes as an atmospheric increase of CO2. Some goes into the oceans, and about 30% goes into the biosphere, into forests in particular. But there is a concern that this biosphere carbon sink is not reliable, is not stable. 2 years ago, there was a strong El Nino event, and we saw a surge in the rate of rise of atmospheric CO2, despite human emissions actually being steady. And this seemed to be linked to this strong El Nino event, this warming off the eastern Pacific. So a key question is this an early warning sign of instability in the biosphere that will make our climate change challenge much more difficult, or is it just interesting interannual variation? Where in the biosphere is this happening? It seems to be in tropical rainforests. This graph shows that the temperature of the tropics very closely tracks the rate of CO2 rise in the atmosphere. So for some reason, tropical regions are belching out CO2 during warm events, and we need to understand that mechanism. In my ERC research, I've been tracking the carbon cycle of tropical forests across all three main tropical continents, in detail trying to understand the mechanism and the location of this mysterious source of CO2 during El Niños. And for this work, we've worked with lots of local partners and students and technicians, and we work in places ranging from the top left, from the slopes of the Andes and the Amazon, to the savannas of Brazil, to the temperate rainforests of Chile, the Congo Basin, and Borneo. And each of these sites, we have researchers going out, spending 1 week every month, tracking in detail the carbon cycle of these forests. We look at the microbial activity in the soil, the activity of the plants, the rate of tree growth, the flow of CO2 through the system, and we also collect local weather data and try and correlate variations in the carbon cycle with variations in the weather. And then we can take global satellite-based weather data and extrapolate our observations to planetary scale and come up with this sort of simulation of the sources and sinks of carbon in the tropical biosphere. So when areas are red, they're emitting CO2 to the atmosphere. When they're green, they're absorbing CO2. And month by month, you can see variation as the weather changes at a local scale. But for the first time, we're able to see this source and sink of carbon in the tropical biosphere at scale. And when we integrate over the time of the El Nino, we can see that in red are the hot spots where CO2 is belching out to the atmosphere during these events. And we see the northern and eastern Amazon is a particular hot spot, but there are also smaller hot spots in the Congo Basin and in Borneo. So what are the mechanisms that are driving these hot spots? Well, one key aspect seems to be the soil, the soil microbial activity. When it gets warmer, the microbes are more active, more carbon is being metabolized and released from the soil. This is probably not a tipping point. As temperatures warm, microbes tend to adapt in their behavior and activity. So this is interesting interannual variability, but this part of the story probably isn't a dangerous early warning of a tipping point. So how well are we doing? When we take our observations and try and predict this global rate of rise of CO2, which you see in the black line there, we see our observations, we're capturing a lot of the variability, not everything. Broadly, we are able to explain a fair bit of that CO2, but the last two peaks we are failing to explain. There's more CO2 going out than we can explain by directly our microbial observations. What's going on there? Well, this is what we saw in Brazil during this El Nino. Fires were leaking out of farms into these temporarily flammable forests and burning the litter layer. These are tiny fires, you can kick them out, they're just litter foils, but they seem to affect the forest. They destroy the root mat and the microbes in the soil, and that seems to cause tree death years later. This is drone footage that I took last month, flying over pristine Amazonian forest near Santarém in Brazil, and then flying over adjacent forest that was primary rainforest, where these fires had gone through, and 60% of the trees are dead in this landscape. And also the forest is now more open, much more vulnerable for the next fire to come through and burn them further. We can map these fire scars. Here they're mapped around the city of Santarém in Brazil, and the total area burnt by these fires was larger than the total area deforested in the Brazilian Amazon in that year. So we're seeing this coupling between climate change and fire is now turning into the larger agent of change in the Amazon compared to direct deforestation. And so this could be the potential tipping point that we need to act on. One thing, though, is fire is something that is directly amenable to policy intervention. We can create early warning systems, we can create fire prevention systems on the ground to try and preserve the forest and stop this potential tipping point in the biosphere that would give us much less room to maneuver in terms of our 2 degrees climate change targets. Thank you.